This is the outline. So largely, I would like to talk about a little of what I'm doing. When I was asked to come and give a keynote today, which was actually in very short notice, I kind of tried to look at what I could share today and what perhaps would really run with the spirit of the session this morning. And largely the activity, the largely this whole day workshop. So what came to my mind is what is really close to my heart and what I've been working on for the last couple of years. And this is around and this is around data. Okay, so this is my outline. So I'll basically talk about something that I've been working on for a while. This is about mobility in Nairobi. Which I'm calling the digital matatu story, and then I'll link it up with some health-related aspects that have been a really, really pleasant surprise outcome that was not initially envisaged. And then towards the end, then I'll kind of look at discuss a little bit about the opportunities that I see in open science. So the digital matatus is largely a collaboration, and I think this really is part of what we are calling here the open science. When we really come together and work together, I think collaboration is one good piece. So it's a collaboration between the University of Nairobi, and then at the University of Nairobi, we have what we call the C4D lab, and then we also have Columbia University. And then MIT, represented by the Civic Design Data Lab, and a small company called GroupShot out of Boston. So, something like 5 years ago, we were trying to understand how people in the low-income communities are able to move around. And while discussing this, the notion of trying to understand how our matatu network works and how it's represented came up. And then we kind of got into a discussion, and then we realized that there was no data available around matatus in terms of where do the actual matatus route go, and actually having this data in electronic form that is computer readable. So we kind of ended up with a segue and ended up looking at matatu data and try to understand the matatu system. And in that process, we also realized that matatus are not only in, or rather the whole concept of matatu, which is basically semi-informal means of communication or buses, is actually a global phenomenon in various countries. So interestingly, then we started getting in touch with other people who are in other countries, kind of also looking at the area about of mobility around matatus, let's say matatus in other countries. And one of the challenges that we're trying to understand is simple information that is readily available in the West. Where does a matatu originate from? Where does it end? Where does it stop? Can we actually digitize this information and actually make it available? The power of that is that then you can use this information or data for planning and other interesting things. But 5 years ago for Nairobi, this was not available. So then we kind of got interested, hey, let's try this and see what we can come up with. So and really thinking about it, some of the things that we realized were the simple tools that we could use were actually at our fingertips. The fact that mobile computing or other mobile phones are available to all of us. On your mobile handset, you can have something that can actually track movement. And this became kind of our default means of trying to collect some basic information to try and understand. So we actually went out the entire city and collected data on Matatu. And what we purpose to do is actually to document it in a machine-readable form, which is largely available in other countries. So we collected this data, and We also represented it. We developed and designed some paper maps. Nairobi has a really colorful map, courtesy of this work by the Digital Matatus. On that map is a lot of detail about where matatus go, where they stop. And you can get this map. It's actually it's a paper-based map. It's actually available from the website. And it's available for the public use. But the most important thing was the data that we had collected and the fact that this data was actually converted into some standard format, which we call GTFS. And I would like to say, I think Nairobi perhaps is one of the first cities to really have this kind of data made available. And here is a rendition, or rather, this is how the paper map looks. It's available for anybody who would like to understand how the matatu system works in Nairobi. You have information about where the stops are, you have information about which matatu goes in what areas, and so on. And then, just discussing, we thought of what would happen if we made the data freely available, that data that we had put together. So we purposed and had that data made available to anybody who would like to use it. We talked to many universities, we talked to the technology hubs, as you know them in Nairobi, iHub, MLab, all the hubs, and we share this information. And then just by opening up that data and making it available, I think is a story that I would like to see or like to discuss today. So I think within something like 3 months, we already had 5 or 6 interesting apps that you could actually download and put on your phone that could give you direction just using that data that was made available. Just by sharing that data, other people are able to use it and are able to make it available to others. I think that's one of the things that I'd like to say was a really good outcome. So there exist a couple of applications out there. I think the most popular one that many of you, Kenyans who live in Nairobi perhaps might know, is Matriroute. Matriroute is basically used for traffic updates. And part of the data that is used by the Matriroute is actually from this particular project, the Digital Matatu project. And through it, you're able to find out, you can actually get information about location, where you can move to. If you like to move from point A to point B, what means you can use, what matatu number you'd use, what time you'll be able to get the matatu, what stops are available, and so on. And then, interestingly, Google got interested in the data. I think I'd like to say that today, that data is actually used by Google Maps. If you get onto Google Maps and you like to try and move from one location to another, this is basically what you'll find. So you'll basically get a map, and once you put in your destination, your source and destinations, it'll give you all the options of matatu routes that are available to you. And this is just possible by just sharing the data, making it open, and other people picking it up and working with it. The other component that really, really rings to this particular workshop today is health. So we also had many researchers who came on board and decided to use the data for different things. And one of them is in the area of space, in the area of health. One group of researchers basically tried to understand access to healthcare. And what they basically did, if you look at the maps, it basically tries to illustrate how many health facilities are around you that you can walk to within 60 minutes, that you can use a matatu within 60 minutes to get to, that you can use perhaps you're driving your own car that you can get to within 60 minutes. And the shade there is... The more red it is, basically shows, kind of gives you the story, kind of tells you that access within 1 hour is guaranteed. But if you look at the first map, which is about, which is walking, which is walking mode of transport, or walking basically, it shows you this, we have a lot of gray and very little red, but a bit of yellow. So where you have here yellow, kind of shows that there's more access in terms of health facilities. Of course, this is linked to, is basically linked to population and so on. But for many cities, it's important to do this kind of work to really show access to healthcare, access to a health facility within a really short time. The second, the transit, the second map on the right-hand side talks about transit. So this is, if you're using a matatu, this is basically what it means. Now here there's the implication of traffic, the traffic situation. So as you can see towards the center, it's more red, so access is more guaranteed. You have access to many health facilities, which could be offering different services. And then as you go outside the city, of course, we move away from this core center. The other map we have is the driving, which is exactly below the transit map on the right-hand side. So this shows if you're driving, you're able to access any healthcare facility within Nairobi, maybe within an hour. And then what we've tried to do is to indicate on the last map, which is indicated as Nairobi map, we've tried to indicate where exactly the facilities are. They're also very related to where the facility, where the populations are. But then this is a really good indication of where and how close facilities are to us. Another illustration I would like to give is accident or crash information, which today is a really big public concern. We have an unproportionately high number of crashes and accidents, we call them accidents here, which are a big burden to the healthcare system. So this information or this map, I'm sorry, doesn't look very clear, but it's basically information that's collected also from social media. And it is kind of in the background, it's a data that we are using to help illustrate where the points are. So the red points basically basically indicate where you have that are accident prone. And this actually was done in collaboration. It's done by a researcher by the name Elizabeth Ressa. And basically what she's done is that she's looked at together with the Mathri route, which have access to, which have an application that many users use on traffic for Nairobi. They've been able to collect information, and within that 6 month period, they would collect a lot of information about where accidents happen. And I think that has turned into a policy discussion. So how can we now try and fix where these problems are, where you can see a lot of these accidents? This is more clear. So this basically shows you where the clusters are, kind of telling you where priority areas should be. So the bigger the balloon, the more challenge, the more crashes you have in that particular location, or the more the crashes were there within that 6 month period. So what you've done here is in the background and kind of being inspired by the Digital Matatu project, this has become a reality just by sharing that original set of data. I think there's a discussion that's going on in terms of fixing where these challenges are. Unfortunately, some of the areas that have the highest accidents are places that have a overhead footpath, but the population or pedestrians are not using them. That's the irony of it. But at least with information, at least you can start figuring out what to do. Is it the design of the flyover that's available, or what could it be? Is it public knowledge, or what could it be? To wind up or to move further, I'd like to say that some of the achievements we've had on this Digital Matatu project was making open transit data and also making available the tools and the methods that we used to do this. And we've also shared all the publications that we've had from this particular piece of work. We've created links across the world based on this data, based on this particular project. And it only happened after we shared the data. So I'm just trying to push the fact that when you talk about open science, a corner piece, I think, is sharing data and sharing resources and sharing tools. We've actually also, being from a computer science background, we've looked at sustainable ways of collecting data. We're using crowdsourcing and what we also call flock sourcing as a way of trying to update and refresh this data. We've actually also had a lot of requests to replicate this particular work in various cities across the world. for example, in Accra, Lusaka, Cairo, and Maputo. But what I'd like to say, or what I'd like to really reinforce, is that sharing the data is what has brought this to the fore. I think in closing, I'd just like to say the following. Opportunities, there are many opportunities that we have within open science, within science gateways. And in my view, if we share the tools, the resources that we have, we're able to provide transparency, and we're able to get other people to do the same, actually for validation purposes, this is actually possible. We're able to replicate the efforts in other parts of the world, in other areas. We're able to learn from that. We're able to collaborate and share data with others. Collaborations, sharing data, and of course, as I mentioned, sharing tools. But even more so, which was mentioned by the DVC in his speech, is how do you bring impact to the research work that we do? One of the things that we've also done within this particular project was to engage the community, engage policymakers, kind of moving that those findings into some kind of action. And I think this has also inspired many, many other pieces of work. Today we have a bike share program at the University of Nairobi. We have a bicycle map and many other interesting things that have really come out of this particular a seed of open data around mobility. These are some of my references, and thank you very much. So.